we ask that everything be done according to your will. May we keep our focus on the reasons we're here. We thank you for continuing to bless us in all the ways that you do. We ask for your continued care and watch over your church everywhere in the country, and that you would increase our faith and give us wisdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus is all
my strength. talks about the coming of the Son of Man, which is Jesus. Soon after the troubles of those days, the sun will grow dark and the moon will no longer shine. The stars will fall from heaven and the powers in space will be driven from their courses. Then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky and all the people of earth will weep as they see the Son of Man coming from the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. The great trumpet will sound, and he will send out his angels to the four corners of the earth, and they will gather his chosen people from one end of the world to the other. You should rejoice in knowing that this is a promise. We believe, and we are the chosen people. So pray that we will do the right things in this life. That's a little prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you have given us a plan that we could be with you. We thank you that you love us and that you send your Son to die on the cross. Now is the time, Lord, that you prepare for us to partake of the fruit and the bread, as you did with your apostles. Help us to remember and to rejoice in the things you have done. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Before we get into that, I've
been thinking about something all week that I thought this would be a good time to bring something up about this. We all pray, of course. I certainly hope we do, and regularly as well. And just a reminder of what I'm thinking about, and maybe we'll remind you and help you in your prayer life. And some of you are probably already doing this. I met a lady last week, and we got to talk about the Lord. And we were talking about praying, and she was talking about, you know, I taught my children to thankful prayers. Thankful as in thanking God for everything. And I was thinking about that. I try to do that now. You know, we pray, we're like children, we are children of God, and we are like children, and we're all kind of asking to give us this, give us that, do this, do that for us. And my thoughts is, I'm trying to, once a day, say a prayer for just thanking God. Thank you, God, for the acts. Thank you, God, for the simple things. Thank you for my children. Thank you for the grass that grows in the land. Just thanks, over and over and over. And that's something that I had not been doing, and she brought that to my attention in the talk. And, you know, we love for our children and our grandchildren to come to us and put their arms around us and tell us how much we're thankful that we are in their lives. And so, God is no different. We pray to Him and ask Him to heal us and so forth. But I don't think we give Him enough thanks for what He really does. A beautiful day this morning, I got up and I thought, ooh, it's windy, cold. Thank you, Lord. Not griping and saying, why did the sun shine? There's a reason, as you know, for all these things. So I continuously try to say thank you, Lord. Thank you for everything, and not just say everything. I try to be specific. And I would encourage you to do that. Maybe you want to take one prayer out of the day and just dedicate it to God and tell Him how much you thank Him and what you thank Him for. But anyways, I thought I'd mention that to you, and hopefully that will bring some thoughts to your mind that you might want to try that as well. We don't have very many write-ins this morning, which is always a good thing. And we'll go with those first, and then we'll get into having you to tell us who you want us to pray for. Betty Anderson, she had a little setback this week. It's doing better now, and she asked for your prayers for her, please. Also, Leon Ramsey, kidney cancer. Claude Ramsey's a brother. I'm taking this written this in. And the last one is Bill Clark, cancer and stroke. So I hope that I got everyone in and got it in correctly there. Is there anyone else here who has a someone they'd like to put into the prayer list?
Bill Rush, family, his daughter called this morning. He passed away this morning. He's been a salesman for 5 years, a good friend of ours. Bill Rush.
Yeah, I knew Bill. I met Bill. Well, we'll be glad to do that. Anyone else? Shirley Rice, okay. Thank you, Shirley. Is there anyone else? Any praises? You know, when we have praises, a lot of times we don't mention our praises that we have for God, but is there someone else that I missed? Yeah.
Brother Landis, I have a praise. We just lost one of our preachers, a Central Christian Church in Bristol. He came there in 1958, and he's helped that church together for that period of time. And I knew him, and he done an excellent job. And I just praise the Lord for his life and his ministry there.
His name is Ross Van Peer.
I beg your pardon?
Ross.
they come back and enjoy it at the church here and to praise you on Sunday as well as through the week. Forgive us, Lord, because we're all sinners. Make sure our hearts right, that we might live the way that Christ would want us to live. Be with us now as we go through our service. Be with Tom as he brings us the message, Lord, and open our hearts and our minds and our ears that we can listen and pay attention and gain from his preaching to us today. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you, Lance. And I'm glad Drew said that because I was going to say something right now, too. You know, he was really one sick young man. 5 days in the hospital when he was 17 years old, that's pretty serious. But I know he was touched because he just told you he was, but the whole family, I mean, there wasn't a day that went by that I wasn't called or asked several times in a day, how's Drew? And I tell you, it's really, like he said, it's so wonderful to be a part of a family that cares about each other like that, and I know we do. So thank you for that. God bless us all. And there he's our Irv back. Where's Mary?
Florida.
Oh, okay.
She didn't have a Long John's.
But anyway, we're glad to see you back. So we're going to stand right now and greet each other warmly, and Hunter's going to take his class down, so let's do that right now.
Hello, Mr.
Thank you.
up with the latest training. They're willing to go to someone's aid on a moment's notice. And many have lost their own lives trying to help somebody else. They are true American heroes.
Amen.
In our scripture today, Jesus tells us what we are to be like in this world. Let's look at Matthew 5, verses 14 through 16. Jesus says this: "You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father." You know, and there's another translation. It's called The Message, and I don't use it very often. But in this case, I want you to hear what Eugene Patterson, how he translates this scripture. This is his version of it. Here's what he says. "Here's another way to put it. You're here to be light, bringing out the God colors in the world. God is not a secret to be kept. We're going public with this, as public as a city on a hill. If I make you light bearers, you don't think I'm going to hide you under a bucket, do you? I'm putting you on a light stand. Now that I've put you there on a hilltop, on a light stand, shine. Keep open house. Be generous with your lives. By opening up to others, you'll prompt people to be open with God, the generous Father in heaven." This is why we're here, folks. I believe that we as the church, people that call themselves Christians, followers of Christ, I believe we are a modern-day spiritual rescue squad. I think that's our mission. There are people who are lost, and we're to go out and help them. Years ago, I shared this modern-day parable, and I want to read it again today. I think it tells a powerful message. It's called a lighthouse parable. I got a picture of a lighthouse to get you in the mood. But listen to this parable. Here's how it goes. "On a dangerous seacoast where shipwrecks often occur, there was once a crude little life-saving station. The building was just a hut, and there was only one boat. But the few devoted members kept a constant watch over the sea with no thought for themselves. They went out day or night tirelessly searching for the lost. Many lives were saved by this wonderful little station, so much that it became famous. Some of those who were saved and various others in the surrounding areas wanted to become associated with the station and give of their time and money and effort for the support of its work. New boats were bought and new crews were trained. The little life-saving station grew and grew. Some of the new members of the life-saving station were unhappy that the building was so crude and so poorly equipped. They felt that a little more comfortable place should be provided as the first refuge of those saved from the sea. So they replaced the emergency cots with beds and put better furniture in a large building. Now the life-saving station became a popular gathering place for its members, and they redecorated it beautifully and furnished it as sort of a club. Less of the members were now interested in going into the sea on life-saving missions, so they hired the life crews to do this work. The mission of the life-saving was still given lip service, but most were too busy or lacked the necessary commitment to take part in the life-saving activities personally. About this time, a large ship was wrecked off the coast, and the hired crews brought in boatloads of cold, wet, and half-drowned people. They were dirty and sick, and many were foreigners and spoke a strange language, and the beautiful new club was considered messed up. So the property committee immediately had a shower house built outside the club where the victims of the shipwreck could be cleaned up before coming inside. At the next meeting, there was a split in the club membership. Most of the members wanted to stop the club's life-saving activities as being unpleasant and a hindrance to the normal life pattern of the club. But some members insisted that the life-saving was their primary purpose, and they pointed out that they were still called a life-saving station. But they were finally voted down and told that if they wanted to save the life of all the various kinds of people who were shipwrecked in those waters, they could begin their own life-saving station down the coast. And so they did. As the years went by, the new station experienced the same changes that occurred in the old. They evolved into a club, and yet another life-saving station was founded. And if you visited the seacoast today, you will find a number of exclusive clubs Shipwrecks are still frequent in those waters. Only now, most of the people drown. Now, I think if you were paying attention at all, you know that this parable is a warning to the church of what can happen when we forget our purpose, when we forget our mission in this world, how we can lose our effectiveness and become something weak and ineffectual. You know, many churches become comfortable social clubs to meet and have a good time. But the lost and dying are looked at as a nuisance, maybe, or a distraction. I pray to God that this would never happen here at First Christian Church. Yes, we can have good times of fellowship. Nothing wrong with that. We can have a good time together, but not at the expense of forgetting our purpose. What is our purpose? We're going to look at that today. First of all, number one, I said it already. We are a spiritual rescue squad. Jesus tells us why he came into the world. After the repentance of Zacchaeus the tax collector, Jesus said this in Luke 19. For the Son of Man came to seek and save what was lost. That's why Jesus said he came. Sounds like a search and rescue operation, doesn't it? And that's what it is. Seek and save. In the calling of Matthew, another dreaded tax collector, Jesus said this in Luke 5. Jesus answered them, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have come not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." That's why Jesus was here. And it's a good thing because we all fit into that boat of sinners. And Jesus handed off his mission to us. The last thing he said before being taken to heaven was this in Matthew 28. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." That's our mission. That's why we're here. If we get too comfortable, we don't go. We stay. And we hope the lost will come to us somehow. It's like that Kevin Costner movie. Remember Field of Dreams? I don't know if you ever saw that. You know, it's a legendary baseball movie. But the story goes something like this. You know, Kevin Costner had a cornfield. And this ghostly people come and they say, "If you build this baseball diamond, you know, the scorned people of the baseball world will come and play in the field." The ghost or something. And the motto was, "Build it, and they will come. Build it, and they will come." I think sometimes we erroneously think that's the way it's going to be in the church. Build a building, and they will come. Well, maybe they will. I hope they will. But that's not what Jesus told us to do. He said, go. Go and get them. Bring them to the building. Invite them to the building. Do something. But don't just build a building and then sit back and relax and watch the doors and see people come flocking in. He said, we're to go. We're to go. There's nothing wrong with having a nice building to worship in. Nothing wrong with it at all. Unless we use it as an excuse not to go and rescue the perishing. You know, I shared this story years ago also. I'm going to share it again because it fits so good. When I was at Milligan College, you know, as a young, crazy guy, you know, I was into all kind of wilderness activities, you know, climbing and rafting and hiking and caving. We went in caves all the time. Well, one night, I'm in the dorm, and it's pretty late, and somebody's banging on the door. And it's a guy that says, "Hey, we got two guys that are lost in a cave. They're both married students. And one of the wives came to us and said, Lou Gabehart was his name. Lou and his buddy are lost. We don't know where they are. We know they went caving, but we don't know what cave. And we haven't heard from them for 12 to 15 hours. Well, since we were the caver experts of the world at that time, we swung into action. You know, we got our gear together. All of us cavers, and we were going to go out to the different caves around Milligan and look for these guys. We didn't argue about things like, hey, whose car are we going to take? Who's going to drive? Who's going to buy the gas? What music are we going to listen to on the way? If we're going to listen to the Bee Gees, I'm not going. I'm not going. Who, what if I get dirty? Who's going to wash my clothes? Do we have to go right now? It's late. Can't we wait till morning? Are we sure they're really lost? We didn't ask any of those questions. The overriding concern was simple. Two guys were lost, and we needed to find them. That was it. So we split up into groups, and we went out looking. Now, can you imagine a rescue squad? You know, here in town, you know, they got the call that there was an accident on the interstate, and they just took their time. Can you imagine that? They say, yeah, there's an accident on the interstate, there's people laying on the road. I said, well, we'll be done in a minute. We're finishing our supper right now. You know, I got to call the wife and make sure I don't need to bring a loaf of bread. You know, it's really kind of late. I mean, we're tired too. You know, and then they got in there, finally got the rescue squads, and they went 25 miles an hour to the scene. What would you think of a rescue squad that acted like that? We'd be outraged. We'd be outraged. What do you, no sense of urgency whatsoever. We want them to be fired immediately. How dare they? Especially if it was our son or daughter laying on the side of the road. We want something done quick. Leads us to point two. We need to have a sense of urgency for the lost. In 2 Corinthians 6, as God's fellow workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain. For he says, in the time of my favor, I heard you. And in the day of my salvation, I helped you. I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. You know, we live in the age of grace right now. We don't know when it's going to end. It could end any second. The Lord could come back at any moment, and the age of grace will be over. And even if he doesn't come today, we don't know when we're going to leave this world. We don't know. Life is fragile. We could be gone in a minute. We don't know when we're going to die, and the opportunity will be gone. Lots of people we know are lost and dying. We are called to be going and telling them about the rescue offered them by Jesus. Some of these lost people are our friends and even family members. Do we have a sense of urgency to reach out to them? Too many times we get wrapped up in little things that don't matter. Well, much of the real mission of the church is left undone. Or if it is done, it's done by just a handful of people who are overworked to the breaking point. You know, reaching the lost and telling them about Jesus is more vital than our comfort. It is. It would be better for us to be doing our mission and be uncomfortable than to be comfortable and let the lost just be lost. We're passionate about so many things. It's nice to have a pretty building. It's always between 68 and 70 degrees, pretty much. How wonderful. But more so, we need to be passionate about lost people. Do we shed tears for them? Are we trying to reach them at all? Or have we given up in our comfort or our apathy? You know, the cave story, it had a happy ending. You know, my group searched this cave called Saltpeter Cave, real close to Milligan. The interesting thing about this cave is all the way in the back of the cave, it had a pond in it, a small pond about 50 to 75 feet in a circle. But this pond was very deep. People said they don't know how deep it went. When we come walking in towards the pond, it was like a little rise. And I remember vividly, I came up that little rise, and there was the pond. And something was floating in it. And the wave of panic and despair went from the bottom of my feet to the top of my head. I thought, oh no. Oh no. We're too late. We're too late. Fortunately, it was just an old life jacket floating in the water. There wasn't a body in it. But it made me think. I asked myself and all of us, is that our reaction to lost people? Are we heartsick about it? Do we saying, who will go for us? And I said, here I am. Send me. I think that's the way we ought to look at it. You know, Lou and his friend were finally found the next afternoon in a cave near Elizabeth, and their lights had gone out. They didn't have any backup lights. They didn't tell their wives where they were going. They made a whole grocery list full of mistakes. They deserved to suffer. But the rescuers refused to give up on them and continued the effort until they were found. That's how we should be with spiritually lost people. We don't give up. Even if they reject us, even if they make fun of us, you can still do something to reach out. So here's my closing challenge to all of us today. You know, we're the hands and feet of Jesus. So let's get to work more than ever. And we also need to show people not only the hands and feet of Jesus, but the heart of Jesus. Let's care. Let's care deeply that people are lost. So here's my challenge to you and to myself. I want you to think of someone you know who does not know Christ as Savior. And after you've got somebody in your mind, I want you to pray for them every day for 7 days. 7 days. I want you to ask God to touch their hearts and for God to draw them to himself. Now you think, that's pretty easy so far. Well, here's the part where it might get a little tricky for you, where it's going to be a little uncomfortable. After you pray for them for 7 days, I want you to go to them. And I want you to tell them that you have been praying for them to accept Christ. Okay? Now, whatever they decide, where they say, no, I'm not going to do that, or, you know, say, yes, you know, I've been thinking about it, maybe they will give their life to the Lord. But whatever they decide, I want you to keep praying for them, either for strength as a new believer, or for God to continue to draw them and to give them more time to keep them safe. To keep them well, to give them more time to make a decision. That's my challenge to every Christian here today. Now, there might be someone here today that doesn't know Christ as Savior. You have just heard what I've said to Christians. And I want to leave you, if you're not a believer and you've never accepted Christ, I want to leave you with this thought. I want you to suppose for 1 minute that I'm your doctor, and I'm also your friend. We're good friends, but I'm also your physician. You come to me with some pain that won't go away. I suggest that tests are run. Test results come back, and it shows that you have cancer. I'm your doctor, but as your friend, I don't want to see you upset by bad news. So I tell you, everything's fine. Tests are okay, you'll be all right. Now, what would you think of me when the truth finally hits home, but it's too late to treat the cancer? You'd be furious with me. You'd probably hate my guts to tell you such a lie. But I did it because I didn't want to make you feel bad. Each one of us, and if you are not a believer here today, you're suffering from a disease common to every human being. Called sin. If not treated, it will result in spiritual death, and you will spend an eternity separated from the very one who could have saved you. And I could tell you a lie and say you don't need to do anything and it will be okay. But I love you too much to do that. The only treatment for your sin is to accept Christ as your Savior and Lord of your life, and then you can be healed. And you can be washed clean by the blood of the Lamb. Right here, right now, but the decision is yours.
Amen.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you, first of all, so much that you love each one of us so desperately that you would send Jesus to rescue us, to seek us out, and to save us with his own blood. I'm so grateful because we couldn't do it ourselves. I pray, Lord, that we would take our mission seriously. That there are people all around us who don't know Christ as Savior. And I pray, Lord, that we would have a new sense of urgency to reach out to them. Maybe they'll still say no. Maybe they'll reject you and us at the same time. But Lord, help us to be bold enough to make the effort to reach out to those that don't know you and to pray for them, that the wall of separation would tumble down. And Lord, if there's anyone here today that doesn't know you, they've heard what we're all about, what you're all about, the love to save them. I pray that today would be the day they would respond by believing in the word and repenting of their sins and doing things your way for a change, confessing you as Savior, being baptized into Christ, receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit, receiving a guarantee of eternal life to come with you forever in a marvelous place that we can't even imagine. May they be rescued today, Lord, by you. We love you, Father. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have a need today, we're going to sing. Please come. If you don't know the Lord, he's ready to rescue you, but you have to let him rescue you. So come forward, please, as we sing. Let's stand together.
Ceremony and a survivor's walk. If you survive cancer, or if you are a caretaker of someone who has survived cancer, we invite you to come and walk with us in our survivor walk. And then later on in the day, there's going to be a wonderful concert by Eddie Shelton at 7:30, followed by the remembrance portion, where we light the luminaries, and if anybody's interested in the luminary ceremony, I can explain a little bit more about that. But they have the lighted bags, and the lights go down. They have a bagpipe player, and we remember those that we have lost to cancer. And then shortly after that, we have an inspiring portion that we call Fight Back, where we inspire and get each other excited about fighting against the cancer. And it is sponsored by different teams throughout the community, and our breast cancer group will have a campsite there at the Relay for Life. And if anybody is interested in that, please come join me. I'd love to have a whole group of survivors to walk with me. Thanks.
Amen. Thank you, Gil. Well, I hope everybody has a good week. Don't forget our Wednesday night services. Hope to see you then. Don't forget our board meeting tomorrow night. Volleyball, lots going on. So hope you have a great week, and I love all of you. Hey, Ron Doss, would you close in prayer?
Sure. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for being able to be here in your house, Lord. We pray that all of us will take the challenge time gave us today to pray for someone who doesn't know you, and then to approach them. And possibly we